Hi everyone, and welcome back to another case of the week. I want to share this case with you, and if you're incorporating implant dentistry into your dental practice, cases like this would be ideal to start out with. And repetition with cases like this will lead you to expanding your knowledge base and your comfort level. You can expand what you're doing within your practice. So for this case, the patient presented with plenty of interproximal space, plenty of bone, so that we can do the proper diagnosis and move forward with the implant placement. So the first visit, the patient comes in and we evaluate periodontal status, obviously the caries, and make the diagnosis and provide some treatment for the patient. And the patient has to be periodontally sound for us to move forward with implant dentistry. Also, I go through a series of evaluation of the radiographs and the cone beam CT scan so that I know how much bone I have and I can go ahead and place the implant in the proper position. So once I have the diagnosis down, I bring the patient back and provide some anesthetic with local infiltration. And once the patient is nice and comfortable with the anesthetic, I can go ahead and provide a full thickness flap reflection so that I can access the bone. In this scenario, I do a full thickness flap. I reflect a full thickness flap, and I want to make sure that I have the access to the cortical plate of the bone. Once I reflect the flap, I'll go through and remove any residual soft tissue. I want to make sure that I have full access to the bone, as you can see here. So step one, have access and be able to visualize where I want to place the implant. And step two is to go ahead and create my initial osteotomy with the start drill. The star drill basically allows me to follow up with additional drills in order to deepen and widen my osteotomy so that I can place the implant. What's really important for me is when I'm placing the implant, I want to go ahead and check with a parallel pin to make sure that my osteotomy is in the right direction. As you can see here, I might be tilted a little bit to the distal or the mesial, and one way to really confirm that is to take a radiograph to make sure that I'm away from the vital structures and I'm not tilted in a direction that I don't want to be tilted in. After the first start drill, I'll go ahead and move to the second start drill before going into the shaping drills. Now the shaping drills for the Hahn implant system are designed so that the shape of the shaping drill is the shape of the implant. And you don't have to worry about depth because it's built into the shape of the drill. You just place the drill to the bone and you can predict how deep it is by where you place the drill into the osteotomy. And again, I want to use my parallel pins, usually at the next step, in order to see whether I'm in the right direction and whether I need to change the angulation. It's really important to move up in the drill sizes and give yourself a chance to correct the angulation if you are off-angled. So that's something to keep in mind, and it's a very systematic process. You don't just go from the start drill to the final shaping drill. You want to move up in width and length of the drill so that you know you have a chance to correct the angulation if you run into any trouble. So moving up the different drill sizes, I get to the final drill, and in this situation, it is a 4.3 by 11.5 millimeter diameter implant, so my final shaping drill is going to match the shape of my implant. Once I've finished osteotomy with the final shaping drill, I'll go ahead and place the implant. You have the option of placing the implant with the torque wrench, or you can use the surgical handpiece, but you don't want to use the same RPM as you're creating the osteotomy. So you want to drop the RPM down to 25 to 30 so that you have a lot more control with placing the implant. Once the implant's in place, you can place a cover screw or a healing abutment. And in this situation, I wanted to place a healing abutment that goes through the tissue. The tissue heals around it after I suture everything. And then I can come back when I want to take the final impression, I can come back and remove the healing abutment and place my impression coping and take the final impression. Also, once I finish the procedure and place the implant, it's fairly simple to place two interrupted sutures. In this situation, we use two interrupted chromic sutures. The tissue was proximated fairly well, and as you can see here, the implant is in place. And now the patient goes through a period of osseointegration before I bring the patient back for the final impression. I want to thank you for your time, and I hope you enjoyed the case of the week. And if you're incorporating implant dentistry into your private practice, cases like this would be ideal and build your skill level and your confidence.